efforts that have taken decades, even centuries, the women's movement, the environmental movements, the human rights movement, the animal rights movements. We still are not anywhere on our animal rights movement when only 2% of American population are vegans. Only 4% are vegetarians. It tells us our movements still need more, possibly better leadership, possibly different ways of communicating. You cannot antagonize people and expect them to support you. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Professor Thurman is one of America's wise men, and he has suggested, and I fully support the notion, that love is a greater, has a greater capacity to heal and bring people together than anger, hate, envy, jealousy, or any other emotion. And what we hate about ourselves, we project upon other people. How can we possibly heal anything if we can't heal our own inner separation of our own spiritual values? And we're all born perfect. I've never met a racist baby. I've never met a hate-filled baby. I've never met a Republican or Democratic baby. I've never met a rich or poor baby. All I've met are perfect spirits. And as long as we align all of our values with that which is spiritual, we then maintain spiritual perception. Our perception becomes our reality. When we look at people, we see the sacredness of life.
Bravo!
So who am I to judge a person in another country that does not agree to our foreign policy? Who am I to suggest that anyone else should not have the luxury of a standard of living and live at slave labor as we do because I need more for myself? That comes from a maladaptive conditioning. And we are a nation of maladaptive people.
That's right.
Even if we think we're well-intentioned, even with those who believe in self-righteousness of their cause, they're thinking frequently from a maladaptive mindset.
That's right.
So we have kids going out, becoming no longer kids, no longer exploring life, no longer making the honest mistakes, no longer engaging with other kids and people, enjoying what it is to grow up and learn from cause and effect and standards and character. Instead, we have kids that become young adults because their parents are so insecure. They want those kids to be perfect like them, and they want them to succeed like them and not be an embarrassment. And as a result, the kid honors that, the kid becomes perfect and becomes a valedictorian first in their class, and they're heralded as special and privileged and sacred, and they go off to Harvard, and suddenly they're depressed because there are 5,000 other kids just like them at Harvard. And now they're all depressed because you're a four-point perfect student, but you're not 4 points with advantages, family with advantages. And now you try even harder. And then you go down to Wall Street, there's 165,000 of you down there. And you think, my God, now I'm really depressed. And then you finally get out of there and you go to Washington because now you think the road has become a legislative aid. Get in the inside of where the power is. And you succeed, but there are 300,000 more like you. And you say, where do I go? And then you become a lobbyist for big industry. And the biggest industries are big pharma, big energy, big education, and big military-industrial complex, and big banking. And now you're on the inside. Now you no longer think about what it is to be spiritual, what life is when it's sacred, the joy of waking up each day being happy instead of trying to work towards happiness. Happiness you don't buy, you don't exceed at. You are happy or not based upon your perception of your own capacity to love and give and share. Those people never find love. They find rich houses in the Hamptons or other places. They find their faces on magazines of how successful they are. They end up as a talking idiot on MSNBC. They want to be in the White House close to it. Everybody, and when they're dysfunctional, you congregate that has power. And the real power in life is your spirit. The false power is your conditioned maladaptive self. And that's where we're congregating, and that's where disease comes from, and that's where reality television and Kim Kardashian's ass and all the other things that we value that we shouldn't, all seven of them. And, well, show me someone else with a big ass that made $200 million. I'm worth about 50 cents. Oh, yeah. I'm from West Virginia. I have to bat sometime. So when I see the problems we have today, and I see how many people who want to be a part of a solution, but they don't have the right idea at the right time, at the right place, with the right support system, and are the right people, I then say, that's because we're not looking in the right place. When we look at Gerald Celente, we look at Ralph Nader. Ralph Nader was the right person, at the right time, in the right place, and we caused more change because of Ralph Nader than any non-politician in American history. He is the American hero that we need. And you do not become less significant, you do not become less viable, you do not become less wise as you age, you become all the more so. And yet the Democratic Party said he was no longer one of them. Michael Moore, he was no longer one of them. When I saw that embarrassing, humiliating performance on Bill Maher, and I thought to myself, what happened to what was once a noble cause of the Democrat and the liberal establishment? I saw it had been corporatized. I saw the egos, I saw narcissism, and the man who was there to lead us was then said he was no longer invited, he was no longer relevant. And I was saying, since when does truth no longer become relevant in solving our problems? Where are your truths leading us, Bill Maher? Where are your truths? So I want to conclude with this thought. We have a new revolution starting. It is in these four corners that starts today, but with us, we, the people, become the new force against ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council. They're passing 22,000 laws at the state level representing 300 corporations, and they did it in secret. We're going to do it publicly because we're taking back the power at the state level, then the federal level, then we're going to demand that you don't go into any war, any conflict, any regime change. You have no right to do that. You do not represent us, we the people. Close down your 800 million base, or your 800 bases, and spending $100 billion a year. Close down the military industrial complex. You only need $1 to $200 billion to keep us safe, not $1.5 trillion. Close down the military capacity to lobby for war instead of lobbying for peace. It is when we stay silent and we do not come out and exercise, when we do not write the articles and do the documentaries, when we stop speaking what we know is the truth, that they get away with empowering lies. We either empower the truth or we empower a lie. Everything in Washington is an empowered lie. You can't find 10 honest people left in Washington, D.C. in political positions. The best thing for Washington, D.C. is to metaphorically make it into a filled toilet bowl and flush it. So to close, I will say this. For those who feel that Ralph Nader is no longer relevant, let me explain this. If Ralph Nader had been elected President of the United States when he first ran, or second ran, we would not have had 9/11 because we would not have had troops in those countries. We would not have been engaged in regime change. We would not have had a crisis in Wall Street because he wouldn't have given a bailout to Wall Street. We would not have had the evisceration of the Glass-Steagall Act. He would have asked for it to be reinstated. We would not have students going bankrupt and living with their parents, and 55% of all graduates living with their parents without a job or no job in the field they were trained in, because we would have had a major movement for free tuition. We would not have had bankruptcy withdrawal as a right. We would not have had the ghettoization of America because he would have reindustrialized all of the urban and suburban areas in the United States. We would not have had 700,000 people stopped and searched and seized assets and put in prison because they showed marijuana in New York City alone last year, because he would not allow stop and search and seizure. We would not have had profiling of African Americans and Latino. We would not have had the ridiculous wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, and the destruction of a right. Look at the most prosperous nation in Africa, the one with the highest level of income and benefit was what? Libya. All right, it's not supporting Gaddafi to do that, but you destroyed everything that was there. What do you have in its return? Hillary Clinton is responsible for that, and the corporate Democrats and Obama as well. Ralph Nader would not have done that. Ralph Nader would not have allowed Detroit to have become obsolete. He would not have allowed all the offshoring of jobs because he would not allow the tax credits and the enormous push to the equity partners to get rid of corporate America. Jobs in America. You wouldn't have had people living off such low wages. He would have encouraged a higher minimum wage. Think of what it would have been if we had universal health care. Think of the people who would be alive today. Think of the people who wouldn't have gone bankrupt. For 12 years, the number one cause of bankruptcy was medical bills. Ralph Nader would not allow that to have happened. Think of, you wouldn't have had the war on genetic engineering. We wouldn't have to be lobbying in every state fighting Monsanto, because Ralph Nader would not have been supporting Monsanto. He'd been supporting organic, sustainable agriculture. You wouldn't have had a corrupt FDA. You wouldn't have had Michael Taylor at the FDA, who was the lawyer for Monsanto, going to head the food safety of the FDA. You would have had the commissioner at the FDA who represented honesty in science and honesty. You would have had the Surgeon General actually going out there and teaching preventative medicine. You wouldn't have had a war on drugs because we wouldn't have a war on drugs. We wouldn't be criminalizing it. You'd have treatment for people. You wouldn't have had 100,000 Mexicans disappeared and 70,000 killed because of a drug war, because you would have legalized drugs, realizing you should allow the people a choice but give them an education on the consequences of that.
Yes.
What a different world if we didn't have prisons filled with people for nonviolent crimes. You wouldn't have had illiteracy because he wouldn't have been promoting charter schools, and he wouldn't have been promoting just taking tests as a determination of a student's competency. We are graduating illiterate students instead of educated students with capacities for thinking critically. He would have honored whistleblowers, not gone after them and thrown more whistleblowers in prison than all other presidents combined. Edward Snowden would be an American hero under Ralph Nader. And Hillary Clinton would be in prison with the buses and the prisons and the training and the entire establishment that involved itself in crimes against humanity. He would honor the Nuremberg Treaty. And so the next time some liberal Democrat tells you that Ralph Nader is somehow no longer relevant, let them know that ain't true. Thank you all.